This is a little bit off-road, the usual protein prediction path. So I will talk a little bit about machine learning. So when I when Professor Rost asked me to give a talk about machine learning, I spent quite some time about sorting out, okay, what can I talk or what I can present to you, which is easy enough to fit into 1 hour, but on the other hand, it should not be too complex and too much details. I came up with the title Machine Learning and Common Sense. So one of the focus or the main parts of the topic is that I want to highlight some hidden assumptions in machine learning which really disappear in the practical work, but if these assumptions are not true, then you will end up in dead ends and you will get very strange results. And actually these are the things which are never really explicitly written in books. If you read paragraphs or book chapters, you somehow can extract this, but maybe it's easier to remember if you see it in clear text. So first of all, the very general idea of machine learning, I think you already heard most of the stuff or at least quite some part in the exercise, but maybe that's sheds a light from a different angle. Some vocabulary and basics, just to make sure that we have a common basis, and then machine learning, bioinformatics, and these hidden assumptions. General idea of machine learning is that you have a device that can generalize from real-world observations into a formal model. This formal model can serve different purposes. On one hand, can be used just to represent the data or to compress it, means saving space and gaining insights and making predictions. So these are the uses of the formal model. Formal means something you can represent in mathematical notation or in a computer. And that's the advantage and also the disadvantage. It reflects only a few aspects of reality. So no model can completely represent the reality. I think if you have maybe a photograph of a dog, it's not a dog, and this difference is quite clear to everybody. If you, for example, have high throughput expression data, it's already not so obvious that you only have a projection of the reality. Okay? This model then should reflect a special concept or the commonalities and not the individual characteristics of your observations. Okay, now let's come to the vocabulary. You will encounter quite often something called inductive bias. This means that every learning scheme, means every algorithm, discards some aspects of the reality to construct a model. That's something you cannot really quantify or describe, but that differs between the different algorithms. And actually, this discarding of information already happens on the level of feature extraction. It means even choosing the types or the values to represent an observation. Think about maybe quite obvious thing, text mining. Somehow you have to decide how to represent a natural language in... Sorry? Hi? You're looking for something?
If you just wanted the criticism for Yale, but you are after...
It's until 2.
Okay.
Okay.
Sorry.
Okay. Okay, where text mining. Yeah, so you have to decide whether you want to represent the nouns, the verbs, if you want to represent a relation between these words, these items, and so on. And implicitly, you already do a lot of design decisions, which finally influences your outcome. Okay. So, and this inductive bias should not be mistaken with the predictive bias, which is actually the prediction error that you can calculate if you evaluate a model. Okay. In the literature, learning scheme refers, or they use learning scheme as a kind of abstract term for machine learning algorithm. Actually, an algorithm is an implementation, or a more realistic version of a learning scheme. And we have this decision trees, rule-based systems, support vector machines, and Bayesian networks, and many more. Attribute or feature, which is actually the same, are variables describing a specific aspect of real-world observations, like body weight, color, and or maybe if a certain property is found or not. That's the simple one. You can also construct more elaborate features by creating maybe relationships between this, maybe not simply body weight, but you something like BME, like body mass index. It's a ratio of body mass to body weight. So you can also have this complex features, or maybe if you know in your data space some certain fixed point with a special meaning, you can also use a distance or the dissimilarity measure to these fixed points to represent your observations. Then these are the columns in the table, and the instances are the rows. A single observation described as describing observed event by assigning values for each feature used to represent this observation. It means it's a set of values from these different attributes. Okay, then we also distinguish different phases in the machine learning. So that means the training phase, it's used to analyze the observations from the real world and derive parameters and the internal structure of the model. With some learning schemes, you can also derive the internal structure. Like in Bayesian networks, you can learn the structure, not only parameters. And yes, and the test phase then is the phase where you apply the model to new instances to determine the reliability of the statements, means of the predictions. And yeah, you should do this on instances not used for the training before. For some instances, you already have a kind of special attribute which you finally want to predict. This is called a label, so it's a kind of privileged attribute. In principle, you could or you can pick any attribute to make it a label and say, okay, that's my prediction task, I want to predict this. But in many cases, you already have a pre-formulated prediction task, and then that's the label. Okay, so there are also other categories you can use to classify learning schemes or machine learning. So it's one is the supervised, and the other is the unsupervised learning. Unsupervised learning are like, for example, concept learning, frequent item sets, or clustering. That's ways to detect internal structure of the data. That means every kind of structure without respect to the label. That means, for example, cluster, you look for similarity between the instances. Frequent item sets, you look for frequent co-occurring subsets of the feature values. Yes, and for this, you do not need a class label yet. So, and then the supervised learning is everything where you consider the label attribute, and which then finally allows you to make a prediction. So that's these two types of learning. Okay. You also, or here the very often data mining, machine learning in the same context. Actually, nowadays it's more or less the same. So it's not 100% the same, but I think I read it in an article. So the data mining, machine learning started as kind of cousins. Now they are becoming siblings. So actually there are two different aspects of the same thing. Data mining is more data and more insight oriented. Machine learning is maybe a little bit more on the technology or algorithmic side, but actually they refer to different sides of the same metal. So statistical learning is also another term for describing this. It's coming for the from the statistical area. So machine learning is more from computer scientists, data mining from the databases. KDD, also sometimes referred to knowledge discovery. It's more or less this whole process of data mining from collecting the data, pre-processing, feature selection, model building, and then prediction. That's KDD is mostly referred to this whole process of all these different steps. Okay, you can also give another, maybe even more similar description, like descriptive or inductive data mining. So descriptive data mining means the part of analyzing the data, and then inductive data mining means simply predicting or predictive modeling. Okay, so when you start to design data mining or machine learning problem, you have to think about your attribute types. So in general, you can distinguish categorical types and continuous types. Categorical types are come in actually in two different things, and the main commonality is that arithmetics does not make sense. You can compare them, means say equal or not equal, but already an ordership means like greater or less, it's only defined on ordinal. Okay, back to nominal. Means you have a set of distinct values for an attribute, and they can be assigned like maybe red, blue, man, woman, and so forth. That means it can have a certain value, but between the values there is simply no obvious relationship. A little bit more information or order is in the ordinal types. It's like a nominal type, but you have an order relationship. That means, for example, if you have newborn, infant, pupil, adult, old man, you have a relationship of is older or is younger than, and you can you already infer some structure or some sequence from this. Unfortunately, most of the machine learning tools do not support ordinal type. So maybe you have to create your own features that you say, okay, you have all kind of nominal values, and then you have additional values where you have the comparisons between this, then you can model this via this way. Okay, the Boolean type, which is often comes as a type of its own, it's actually a special type of nominal, so it can be either true or false. Okay, then the other big section of variable types are the continuous types. So first we have the integer type, which is still also resembles somehow nominal type, but arithmetic makes sense. For example, if you have maybe number of children or your yearly income, so you can add or subtract, you can compare the numbers, means greater or lesser is makes sense, and yeah, so this is regarded as continuous type. Then these tools are very similar, but they have some subtle differences. The interval scaled contains numerical values measured in equal intervals, but from an arbitrary set origin. For example, if you have the temperature in degrees Celsius. And the peculiar thing is that zero doesn't mean actually zero in the sense of not existing. So that's the point you have to keep in mind. It is ordered, and arithmetic makes already sense. And then the ratio scaled, there are even less limitations than interval scaled. Means has the interval scaled values, and here zero means really zero. It means if a temperature in Kelvin, then then it means you have no temperature, or for example, if you have an income of zero, then means really no money. If you would have it here on like this, maybe comparison to an average income, then this has already different meaning. Okay. So after describing the data, we have different phases in the data pre-processing, or in the the extraction. So first, it always starts with feature extraction. Then you might have a kind of discretization, and later on the feature selection. Then you have a data set which you actually feed in your learning scheme. Okay. So in detail to this step. So what does feature extraction or construction mean? That's a conversion of these observations. They can come in any form: natural text, numbers, images, and so on. And you have to convert this into a formalized computer readable representation. That means you have to define an attribute type, and you have to assign appropriate values to this attributes. And as you might see for images, you need already quite some sophisticated tools to understand or analyze images, but also for maybe text mining, you need some specialized text mining libraries or other things coming from signal analysis. These sometimes are very complicated mathematical tools. So that's actually a field of its own, right? And especially in the field of bioinformatics, where you have a strong attachment to biology, you should also make use of an analyst. That means feature extraction construction is highly background knowledge dependent, and the problem is, the information you drop here at this point will never come back. That means if you define the wrong features because you make a mistake or you don't talk to an expert, then this is gone. And you will not be able to find any signal again if you drop this. Okay, again here, you should always work with the common sense. That means, what was the quote in one of the books? Results will lose against appeal. So that means if it appears unconvincing or contradicting to your experience, people might reject the results. So that's one thing. That means if you have something very strange, you should be able to prove it, make really sure that it's useful or making sense. Because that's an important thing at this stage, and that's a good point to integrate the background knowledge from domain experts. Okay, once you have this feature defined and the values, there is a next step of pre-processing, mostly this discretization. It means you convert a numerical attribute into a categorical one. Why is this necessary? So think of maybe if here's the value, and that's the range of the attributes, the range of the instances, and some instances, for example, have, if you have a distribution like this, this might be quite obscure or very, very complex. And actually, what is maybe more realistic and gives more insights, if you define, say, okay, we have actually quite some high values, then we have a substantial fraction of instances with this value, and then we have maybe a third population. And by boiling this down into three values and assigning these nominal values, you simplify the data, and it's easier to understand, because then you say, okay, in general we distinguish three states, and we do not distinguish many similar or more or less dissimilar states. Okay, you discard some of the data, but actually it makes the data better manageable and focuses on the general or on the concepts of this behind this data. Okay, that's here the formal definition. You split the value range in a set of discrete intervals, and you can, for example, use then the interval label as value, and this can help to avoid overfitting. Here again, there exists several strategies. An unsupervised strategy, that means without respect to the class label, is domain dependent. For example, if you, we had this example with the age of humans. Maybe you have a newborn. It's maybe age less than 2 weeks or 4 weeks. Then we have babies between 4 weeks and 12 months, and then pupils, you say, okay, 1 year to 5 years, and then so on. That's domain dependent, and yeah, you can implement your background knowledge into this. Or more mathematical structures, equal width. That means the bins or the intervals have all the same size or equal frequency. That means have the same number of instances in each bin. Or you can also try to partition this attribute in respect to the class label. Then that's called a supervised discretization. Then you apply mathematical tests to check, okay, where is the which margins or which borders gives the best separation in respect to the class label. Okay. So now we have converted our examples or our instances into features. We did a feature discretization where we're applicable, and now we can boil down the number of features by feature selection. What is the goal of feature selection? First of all, it actually means remove values from instances. That means we discard some information. Why should we do this? First of all, features might be irrelevant. Irrelevant feature, in the best case, it only consumes space and computation time. In the worst case, it introduces noise to your data. Or if it's a redundant feature, that means you introduce actually the same information twice. That means you increase the weight of this feature, and this might lead to a imbalance of the weights between the features, and because you rate one feature higher, and this can bias your prediction in the end or your presentation. Okay, so and possible benefits here: you improve efficiency and accuracy. Of course, a smaller data set means shorter runtime. You can fit it maybe in or more instances into the main memory. You can do it maybe on your laptop, and you don't have to go to the cluster. You prevent overfitting because you remove individuality from the model, and yeah, you save space. Okay, what kind of strategies can we use? Again, feature selection comes in an unsupervised and supervised form. Unsupervised, again, here you can do feature selection based on expert knowledge, if you have an expert or if you have already some prior experiences, or you can do random sampling. Random sampling is an acceptable strategy if you have a very large number of attributes, if your understanding is over the different features is quite the same. That means actually you do not really understand what the features mean. You have just maybe 10,000. Then you can try to start with a random sampling, and yeah, and since you do it random, the chances are quite good that you do not introduce a very big bias. Okay, then much more common is a supervised feature selection. That means you pick the single features in respect to their influence on the prediction performance. That means the more information a feature contains for the prediction, the earlier you should pick it. And yeah, that's also called filtering. There are actually, you can calculate some statistics. That means that that's a statistic, or that's Gini index, information gain relief. These are different statistics which calculate the coupling between this attribute and the class. So that's that's simple calculation. Or you can do a kind of wrapping. This actually uses the prediction performance with a certain machine learning scheme to determine whether a feature is useful or not. That means here you do math according to a simple formula, and here you, instead of the formula, you put in the attribute into a learning algorithm. How can you imagine this? Okay, you start, you pick the first attribute, learn a model with this attribute, and determine the prediction performance. Then you take the second, and in the end, you pick out the attribute with the best prediction performance. Then you pick a second attribute. It means, and with this, you can increase the number of features you use, and either you start with a defined set of features. Means, okay, you only want to pick 10 features, or you observe how is the performance improved by new features, and then you have also a certain threshold that, okay, new features do not really add better performance, then you stop this. Okay, that's the forward selection. You means you increase the set of features one by one. There is also the other way around, backward elimination. You just start to dropping attributes and see how the prediction performance drops. And I think with the least important features, you should observe nearly no decrease in the prediction performance. And then when you see, okay, there is a steep decrease in the prediction performance, you stop and say, okay, I go with the rest of the features. Okay, actually, for these strategies, you assume that there is no dependence between the features. So that means there might be the fact that a feature is only informative if it comes as a pair, but then you have a combinatorial explosion, because then you would have to check every possible subset of the features. That means it's 2 to the power of n, and this is simply impossible to calculate for the most sets, so that's the reason why you normally ignore this. Okay, so that was all the machine learning background. Let's come to the relation to bioinformatics. Actually, we have to span these two extremes. I will go to this a little bit quicker, because I think you will know much of this. If you have questions, just interrupt me. Okay, so on one hand, we have the statements, or the information on the nucleotide level coming from the high throughput sequencing things. On the other hand, we want to have statements on the individual or population level, and that's a span of several magnitudes, and the mapping between this level is very difficult, and this gain in speed has clearly outpaced simply the analysis of knowledge discovery. So some curves, for example, here, number of bases 1 to the 12, even if you only look at the words, so means the sequences, it's in the range of 1 to the 9 of different nucleotide ranges. This converts to 70 million of protein sequences. Currently, I think the numbers are from last week, so they are quite recent. Actually, again, on here, on this level, we discarded quite some information, because we assume that in the proteins, all the information from the DNA is kept, which we actually know that is not true, because we have introns, we might have regulatory elements which never are converted into proteins. So already here we lose quite some information, and that's the growth curve of Swissprod. Here in 2010, there was a policy change in Swissprod. That means they really want to have higher confidence in all the information. That means they start to weed out weak information or redundant entries. You have a question? Or? Okay, you see that means that the growth rate is clearly decreased. So and here we are in the range of 500,000, and yeah, in the sequence level we are currently at 70 million. So and yeah, so that's the estimated growth rate, and that's the growth rate here. So I think that the gap is quite obvious, and I think the growth rate or the available specialists are approximated by this line here down below. So that means analysts simply cannot speed up because human reading speed is limited, and the number of analysts also, and the money. And that's here the growth rate of PDB. So it also grows quite drastically, but we are now in the range of 100,000 structures in the middle of 2014. So here is where data mining, machine learning kicks in. It helps to structure the data and to compress the data because space is already an issue in our lab. We have a data of approximately some 100 terabytes. And this is already a non-trivial protein. It means simply copying data or make a backup of the copies takes several hours or days. And that's the point where you then slowly run into a performance plateau, because the simple operations already take so much time that it's difficult to do something meaningful. On the other hand, it can be used to filter out mistakes. Mistakes are really an issue, so because all the data generation is now done automatically, nobody would ever detect failures. So maybe there was a bad mixture in the sequencing reaction and so on. Okay, there are also pre-processing filters in this step, but it's simply too much data volume to have a curator sitting there and correcting mistakes. You can also detect outliers from errors, noise, and then have already a first line of filtering and reduce redundancy. High throughput sequencing is just a brute force effort. You sequence everything, and the project do not really care whether you have maybe 20 times the same sequence in it, and these are submitted to the databases, and then it's your responsibility, if you download maybe the results of your query, to figure out what is really new and what is different and what is redundant. Okay, and I think that's also here the one of the main goals here in our group, that we want to make predictions which replace the wet lab analysis. Wet lab has increased speed in the last decade significantly, but by far not in the dimension as the sequence technology, and because there is still many manual work included, and the number of specialists and the daily working hours are simply the same, so there is no big space left to grow here in this speed. So we have to do this with predictions, and we can also use this to detect interesting relationships between in the data, and then direct manpower towards this point where it's really needed. Okay. So the general step how this knowledge detection goes is defined here already quite some years ago by Fayyad. It means first you have the data, and you select the target data, means everything you think could be interesting for you. Then you apply first pre-processing step, you create features from this, and then do some data mining on the features, and you end up with some patterns. Patterns are local structures. This helps you to construct global models. And then if you interpret these models, or the models can explain the data, then you reach something like knowledge. So I think this is still valid. So you have a very important reduction in data volume. Okay, so here on this chart you see the machine learning algorithms used in bioinformatics. What is quite surprising, or might be surprising, that the artificial neural networks is still a very important player in the field. Actually, it dominates this. So it started already here in the 80s with domination, and then for long or for some decades was number one. It's still number one, but I think it lost some territory to support vector machines. Yeah, so support vectors gained some space, and the latest development is that now random forests also becoming more and more important for the field of bioinformatics. You will also notice a very strong coupling between decision trees and random forests. This is due to the fact that random forests are built of decision trees, and they mined our publications, and so that means because random forests are built or made out of decision trees, these two are co-mentioned. This also explains why here you have a strong coupling between decision trees and random forests. Okay, so now I want to give some explanations or possible explanations why artificial neural networks or support vector machines are so important for bioinformatics. Because they, or even if they are black box models. From black box models, it's more difficult to extract knowledge compared to maybe rule-based or decision tree-based systems. But they are capable to handle a huge number of attributes. So since biology is very complex, and for example, proteins, you have a protein sequence and you use maybe every single position as a feature, you have already a large number of features, and they are quite robust against uninformative features. That means they are able to figure out which feature are important or which feature matters and which don't. That means they do some work for you. If you don't have background knowledge and say, okay, this is important, this is not, throw everything in and then let the algorithm sort out, and they work sufficiently well. Okay. So this is good, but one of the problems here is since these are very computational intensive and demanding, and the data are growing, I think we reached a point where we have to put more effort into data pre-processing. That means construct better features and doing better reduction of the data set to make still use of the whole power of these tools. Okay, so and now some underlying assumptions in machine learning, and some possible pitfalls you might encounter if you employ machine learning into your experiment. So that means actually these assumptions are important in the various pre-processing steps, and the overall performance or performance at all depends if assumptions hold or not. But the pity is you cannot really check it. The only thing is that you should be aware of, okay, you make a decision and you assume that something is work, and in the end it's like for you a kind of a break point where you can go back and see, okay, can I branch in a different direction and maybe improve my outcome. So first, actually, if you do machine learning, you assume that your distribution, background distribution, is uniform over time. That means, for example, if you learn a model to describe maybe dogs, and during the time you train your model, that dogs are mostly not larger than maybe 50 centimeters in height, And then after some time, your dogs have evolved, which have maybe a height of 1 meter. You have definitely a problem because the distribution changed over time. So with biological entities, that's sometimes difficult, but the underlying distribution might be different. So that might somehow reduce your confidence of prediction. What can you do to solve or to try to relieve this problem? Use many features to represent complex scenarios, because that means if the distribution in a certain feature changes, you still have maybe others which are more conserved. So this might balance out specifications in only a small aspect. So, and if you have a lot of data, you can try to apply some stream algorithms. Stream algorithms are inherently need to forget. That means they simply cannot store information about all the instances, but it means the parameters of the model are constantly updated as new instances are seen. So that means you're always up to date with your model. Okay, that's the big difference to the other models, where you have one training set. That means you more or less you fix the parameters for the data at this time, and you assume that later on, when you apply this model to test data, the parameters are still the same. Okay, for example, if you only have examples here in this range and you want to train the based on the examples included in this bubble, you could maybe easily fit a line through this, and this is actually quite good. But then if over time maybe the individual size shrinks or so, it's quite obvious that this model will not explain this data very well anymore. Okay, another important thing is unfair sampling. Due to experimental reasons, the sample which you can analyze represents only a special subset of the entities. So for example, think about solvable and transmembrane proteins. Transmembrane proteins are much more complicated to extract and to crystallize. So that means the model normally is based on soluble proteins, and once you want to predict special features of a transmembrane proteins, it will perform weak because the model was not really meant for this. That's especially difficult if you have maybe this instance-based learning or lazy learning methods like k-nearest neighbor. What you can try to counteract these problems means remove redundancy, that you have instances more or less spread evenly over the feature space. Use stratification, that you make sure that in your sample you have the same distribution as in the rest of the universe. And also check the variance. It means how big is the difference between the different runs and different predictions. And then you can maybe have special attention to difficult instances. For example, like this is the feature space, and means that they have the features X and Y, and you have here a denser population because you have more example picked from this area. And then if you want to do maybe a K nearest neighbor, and you see K, this example is quite in the middle between these two instances and this, but if you have this majority vote, you would say okay, then the final label is strongly influenced by these instances here, simply because of the fact that we have here 2, 4, 6, 7 instances on this side and only one on this. So I think if you are here in this more evenly distributed area, it's less difficult because you have only one on this side within this range of nearest neighbor, and that it's not so difficult. If you are at the border of such a densely populated area, you might be biased. For example, if you're exactly right in between, then it gives you maybe a higher resolution. So that's the That's the positive of the effect. If you have more similar instances, then for example, if you have an instance here, then you have a lower resolution in the structures. Okay, so another thing, it's a suitable representation. Actually, that's what you normally do not really challenge, but it's quite essential that you have, we assume that we have a feature set that can represent the concept you want to learn. We do not often really know the causal relationships between these features and maybe the target label, and we can also mistake employed features with the real causing ones, so because we don't know better. So, for example, you have the numbers of storks and birds in Germany decreased in the last decades, and you could then, if you are not careful, you can conclude that, okay, number of birds depends on the number of storks. Okay, or the relationship between opening umbrellas and rain. So you can say, or you could conclude that opening umbrellas cause rain. So obviously we know better because we have background knowledge about the system, but that's a quite subtle thing that you make premature conclusions. Here, and this is with the representation of the concept. If you look at this, so I took this, I think it's quite a classical data set, play tennis, but I misused it for my purpose. So if you see at these features, I think it's very difficult to tell whether you're going to play tennis or not. But actually, it seems okay, looks all reasonable. Because you might think that these attributes determine the final decision, even if it's difficult to determine. So, but I simply rephrased this data set a little bit, and now it becomes much more obvious that maybe the truth behind the data is different. So if you see, okay, actually, if you have this feature, makes a big difference than not, because now it becomes obvious actually it more or less depends on the body. If you have a body for playing tennis and not there, and that's, I think that's the biggest challenge, especially for bioinformatics, that you have the right features in it. That's also the reason why you have such methods like neural networks or support vector machines, where you throw in everything you have just for the sake, not dropping your favorite body attribute, because once you drop this, you might come up with a model of this which also might perform to some extent, but actually that's this might obscure the true relationships. Okay, so these are, I think that's the last slide for my hidden assumption. Oh no, performance estimation. Okay, how much? Okay, so yeah, that's also a short recap. So as I mentioned before, the training model discards, or training a model means discarding some information and keeping others. And this depends on the learning scheme. Actually, instance-specific information should be discarded and not kept into the model, because this leads to overfitting. And then overfitting, we call this when a prediction model is biased towards this training example. That means we have a better performance on the training examples because it somehow remembers the individual instances and not the general idea what we want to learn. Okay, so how can we get a more realistic estimation? I think the most optimistic thing is the resubstitution error. That means you simply throw in all the training examples and determine the performance on this. So if you have a better performance than the resubstitution error, you should, or you will either get a Nature publication or a big bang. That means there's something went completely wrong, or you find this, because I think this will never happen. I think that's the best result you can ever get. But more realistic one is to have it to determine the error on an independent test set. If you have enough data, if you have less data, for example, a very small data set, you can just leave one out cross-validation. That means one example or one instance is held out for testing, the others remain for training, and then after n iterations, you average over the n results, and that's your estimation. This is still quite biased, but okay, if you have a small data set, there are no alternatives, and you can use this to check the influence of the individual instances. It means how robust, how stable your model is. So for example, if you have 100 or 150 instances and you observe maybe large fluctuations between the performance, you see, okay, something in your presentation is still very instance specific and maybe not on the general concept. Okay, I think the gold standard or the most common thing is the cross-validation. Typically comes as tenfold cross-validation. You partition the data in n partitions, use n minus one partitions for training and the one for the performance assessment. After this, you cycle through all the partitions, that every partition is used once as a holdout, and then you average the performance again. And which is very essential, every step where class information is considered. Might this be feature selection or maybe even feature construction should be included into the loop. Don't do a supervised feature selection and then a tenfold cross-validation, because that's already cheating since you use class information outside the loop, and then this will get you biased results. Okay, here are some textbooks. So I think about machine learning theory and much more elaborate stuff, including all the math formulas, can be found in the Mitchell book. Introduction to data mining for life sciences is a quite comprehensive coverage of the field with a lot of examples. And here, this is a quite useful book, the data mining. Third edition, it's actually the Wicker manual, but also includes some very useful theoretical chapters if you don't want to read a whole book about feature selection or single algorithms. Okay. Thank you for your attention. I think next week Professor Rost is back, and sorry for the overtime.